We'll start the online lecture on polynomials and inequalities. The first part we'll deal with polynomials, next we'll go over to inequalities. So let's move on. The outline is as follows. First we'll deal with fields, which are abstract sets with certain properties. Then we'll see polynomial functions over a field. Let's, for example, over R and C you have seen polynomials like x, x squared, x cubed plus x power 5 plus x power 6 and so on. Next we'll move on to division algorithm of polynomials over a field. Like for example in number theory you have seen dividend equal to divisor into quotient plus remainder. We will see a similar result for polynomials also. Next we'll restrict our attention to the set of complex numbers and look at polynomials and their properties on complex numbers. We'll move on Vieta's relations in C, which are basically the relations between roots and coefficients in polynomials over C. Next, we'll deal with the roots of unity, that is solutions of the equation x power n equal to 1. And then we'll deal with types of roots and their multiplicity. Then we'll move on to some special topics like Lagrange interpolation, integer polynomials, that is polynomials with integer coefficients, reciprocal equations, that is equations which have a certain sort of symmetry in them, and at the last we will deal with polynomials in multiple variables and see a certain special example called symmetric polynomials. Now we move on to abstract fields. What is a field? Suppose we have a non-empty set S on which there are two binary operations, dot and plus. By binary operation, I mean a function from S cross S to S. So this S will be called a field when certain properties are satisfied for addition and multiplication. First property is our closure law. Look at the screen. If A and B are in S, then A plus B has to be in S. Similarly, if A and B are in S, then A dot B has to be in S. Next, we have commutativity, which says that if A and B are in S, then A plus B is same as B plus A. Similarly, A dot B is same as B dot A. There is no difference. Next, we have a law called associativity, which shows us in which order we have to do the operations. And it says that it is irrelevant. Suppose A, B, and C are in S, then suppose we add B and C first, and then we add A to it, that will be same as if we add A plus B, and then we add C to it. Similarly for multiplication, multiply B and C and then you multiply A with it, that will be the same as if we multiply A and B and multiply C with it. Next is the existence of additive identity, which says that there is an element called 0 in S for which A plus 0 and 0 plus A are same and both of them are equal to A. And then we have a multiplicative identity called 1, which satisfies the property that A into 1 is same as 1 into A, which is same as A. Then we have the property of existence of inverse, which is a bit different in addition from multiplication. For every element A in S, there exists a unique additive inverse B to satisfy the property that A plus B and B plus A are same and both of them are equal to 0, the additive identity. This B will be denoted by minus A. Now, for multiplication, we cannot include 0. 0 does not have a multiplicative inverse. You have seen that in R, and that has to be true in an arbitrary field. That is how it is defined. If A not equal to 0, then there exists a unique inverse B such that A dot B is equal to B dot A is equal to the identity element. And B will be denoted by A inverse. Sometimes we will abuse the notation a bit and denote it by 1 divided by A like we do in real numbers or complex numbers and so on. Now the question is that all? Are these rules required? But a natural question arises. We have two functions on S, that is A from S cross S to S, that is to binary operations plus and product, but you don't know how these two functions interact with each other, right? So we need an answer to that. We have an additional property called the distributivity property. You have seen in R the set of real numbers and also in C the set of complex numbers, which says that A dot B plus C is same as A dot B plus A dot C for any three elements, not necessarily distinct, A, B, and C in S. And this property has to hold in a set for it to be called a field, in addition to these properties of addition and multiplication. So now we come to some exercises. First exercise is show that the set of rational numbers, that is numbers of the form P by Q, where P and Q are integers, Q is non-zero, and the greatest common divisor of P and Q is 1. This set is a field under the usual laws of addition and multiplication that you know. Now let S be the set of all Cauchy sequences of rational numbers. By Cauchy sequence, I mean a sequence n which satisfies the property that if you are given any epsilons greater than 0, then there exists a natural number n naught for which, for any natural number m greater than n greater than equal to n naught, mod of a minus an is less than epsilon. That is, the terms get closer and closer to each other as we move farther. So we define a relation on S by saying that xn is related to yn if and only if this limit as n tends to infinity xn minus yn is 0. Now the exercise is to show that this relation is an equivalence relation. Now let us consider the equivalence classes of the above relation. This set of equivalence classes is the definition of the set of real numbers, that is the formal definition. Let xn and yn be two such equivalence classes, that is the equivalence class of the sequence xn and the equivalence class of the sequence yn. Now the exercise is to show that xn plus yn, this sequence is Cauchy, as well as the sequence xn yn is Cauchy. Now we move further and let us define the sum of the two equivalence classes, equivalence class of xn and equivalence class of yn, as the equivalence class of xn plus yn. We can define it because xn plus yn is also Cauchy by the previous exercise. Similarly, we define the product of the equivalence classes xn and equivalence class of yn by the equivalence class of xn yn. Now the exercise is to show that these binary operations are well defined. By well defined, I mean that suppose the equivalence class of xn and the equivalence class of xn dash are the same, and the equivalence class of yn and the equivalence class of yn dash are the same. Then you have to show that the equivalence class of xn plus yn is same as the equivalence class of xn dash plus yn dash. Similarly, the equivalence class of xn yn is same as the equivalence class of xn dash yn dash. Further, R under these rules forms a field. Now let us define the set of complex numbers with a set of expressions of the form a plus iota b, where a and b are real numbers. Iota is basically the square root of minus 1, but right now we'll just take it as a symbol instead of specifically mentioning that it is the square root of minus 1. Now let us define the sum and product of two complex numbers a plus iota b and c plus iota d as a plus b plus iota c plus d and ac minus bd plus iota ad plus bc respectively. You have to show that c under these rules, multiplication and addition, forms the field. Last exercise is to show that if p be a prime number and we consider the set fp equal to 0, 1 and so on up to p minus 1, suppose we are given a and b in fp, let us define the sum of a and b in fp as the unique remainder in the set fp on dividing a plus b by p. Similarly, let us define the product of a and b in fp as the unique remainder in fp on dividing a dot b by p. You have to show that fp under these rules forms a field. Next, we have polynomial functions over a field. Let f be any arbitrary field, a function f from f to f defined by f of x equal to 0 for all x in f is called the zero polynomial or the identically zero polynomial. A function g from f to f of the form g of x equal to summation ai x bar I, where I runs from 0 to n, where n is greater than equal to 0 for all x in f, and ai belongs to f for all 0 lesser than equal to I lesser than equal to n and an not equal to 0 is called a polynomial of degree n. The zero polynomial, that is f of x equal to 0 for all x in f, has no defined degree. You say that the degree is undefined. Some examples: ax square plus bx plus c, where a is not equal to 0, is a polynomial of degree 2 over R, where a and b and c are real numbers. Then we have ax cube plus bx square plus cx plus d, where a is non-zero, is a cubic polynomial, that is, it has degree 3 over R, where a, b, c and d are again real numbers. Further, we also have quartic and quintic polynomials, that is degree 4 and degree 5 polynomials over R, defined in the similar way. Now, over complex numbers, suppose we have an expression of the form px square plus iota qx plus r, where p, q and r are complex numbers and iota is the square root of minus 1. It is a quadratic polynomial over C. And similarly, we can also define cubic and quartic and quintic polynomials over C. Now, let us come to a finite field F2, that is modulo 2. 2x cubed plus 3x square plus 4x plus 1 in this field is same as x square plus 1. That is because 2 is same as 0 modulo 2, 3 is same as 1 modulo 2, 4 is same as 0 modulo 2, and 1 is just 1 modulo 2. So 2, 3, 4, and 1 are equivalent to 0, 1, 0, and 1, respectively modulo 2. That's why these two polynomials are the same over F2. So the degree of a polynomial over a finite field may not be a fixed number. For example, over Fp, that is the set of integers modulo p, where p is a prime number, the polynomial xp minus x is identically 0, that is x power p is equal to x by Farman's little theorem, where p is a prime. And the left side has a degree p, you can see clearly, and the right hand side has a degree 1. So whenever we talk about the degree of a polynomial function over a finite field, we must fix a particular way of representing the polynomial and work with it throughout. For example, while solving a problem, we cannot write x and x power p interchangeably if we want to talk about the degree of the polynomial. If the degree is nowhere involved, then we can definitely write that. Now we have division algorithm over a field. Let f and g be two polynomials over an abstract field f, such that g is not the identically zero polynomial. Then there exist unique polynomials q and r over f, such that f of x is equal to g of x into q of x plus r of x for all x belongs to f, and either one of the following conditions hold. R is identically zero, in which case f is said to be divisible by g over f, or 0 lesser than equal to degree of r lesser than equal to degree of g minus 1. Further, for an infinite field, these polynomials q and r are unique if you are given f and g. So what this theorem says is that if g is not 0, then if you have any other polynomial f, you can divide f by g and you get a quotient q and a remainder r. And r can be identically 0, in which case g is said to divide f. But if r is not identically 0, then it has a well-defined degree. Let's call it degree of r, dig r. And 0 is lesser than or equal to degree of r, and that is lesser than the degree of g. Proof of the division algorithm. First, we deal with the special case when f is identically 0. Then you can take q equal to r equal to 0 and we're done, because 0 equal to 0 into g plus 0. Else, f has a degree, let's say n, which belongs to n star. N star is the set of natural numbers union with 0. The idea is to use induction on this n. For n equal to 0, f is a constant polynomial. Now, case 1 is g is non-constant. In that case, the degree of f is already less than the degree of g. So we can take q equal to 0 and r equal to f, and we are done. Else, if g is a constant, then you can take q equal to f into g inverse and r equal to 0, and then you are done again. Assume now that the hypothesis holds for n lesser than or equal to k, for k belongs to n star. Suppose f has degree k plus 1. First, we deal with the simple case when degree of f is already less than the degree of g, in which case we can easily take q equal to 0 and r equal to f, and we are done again. Otherwise, degree of f is greater than or equal to degree of g. And now we need a polynomial of degree at most k somehow to apply the induction hypothesis. So let us do some wishful thinking. We want a lambda belongs to f of x, and this notation f of x denotes the set of all polynomial functions over f. And we want lambda so that the x power k plus 1 coefficient of f plus lambda g is 0, so that we can apply the induction hypothesis. Now let a k plus 1 and b m be the leading coefficients of f and g respectively. Observe that if we take lambda is equal to minus a k plus 1 into b m inverse into x power k plus 1 minus m, then the x power k plus 1 coefficient of f plus lambda g will be 0. Just multiply it out and see. And hence f plus lambda g has degree at most k. Now we can apply the induction hypothesis on f plus lambda g. Now it is a good exercise to complete the proof of existence. Apply the induction hypothesis and complete the proof. Now let us come to the uniqueness of the quotient and remainder. We need a few lemmas for that. Lemma 1 is, using the idea of proof, it can be shown that this q can be selected in such a way that it has degree n minus m, where n is the degree of f and m is the degree of g and n is greater than or equal to m. Lemma 2 is, it can be shown that a polynomial of degree n has at most n distinct roots. It is an exercise to prove these two lemmas. It is not difficult to prove them. F is a polynomial over an infinite field f such that f of x is equal to 0 for all x belongs to f, then each coefficient of f is 0. So the property that f is an infinite field is an important criterion to show that if f of x takes the value 0 for all x, then indeed each coefficient has to be 0. Note that it is not true in general, because suppose we have the polynomial x cube minus x in f3, then by Fermat's little theorem, x cube is congruent to x for every integer x. So x cube minus x is always equal to 0 in f3. But f3 is a finite field, so you cannot expect it to be true in any way. Now lemma 4 is, suppose f and g be two polynomials over an infinite field such that f of x into g of x is identically equal to 0. That is, f of x into g of x is equal to 0 for all x in f, then you have to show that either f or g is identically 0, both inclusive, that is, both of them can be 0. This also uses a property of the field, that is, it's an infinite field. Now, a hint to prove these two lemmas: write down the coefficient of x power k on both sides of the equation and use lemma 3 in order to prove lemma 4. And in order to prove lemma 3, just substitute sufficiently many values of x and conclude that each coefficient is 0. We have a remark. There is a concept of formal power series in which we can define a polynomial ring over a field. It's a different kind of definition of polynomials. There, the condition of infinite field is not necessary to arrive at the results of the preceding lemmas. That is because in that definition, the polynomials are defined uniquely using their coefficients. So the uniqueness of quotient and remainder will also hold in that definition in case of finite fields. Consider polynomials as formal power series instead of functions. We won't go into this. These are really difficult topics of undergraduate abstract algebra. So now we have a proof of uniqueness. Let f be an infinite field, and suppose you have two distinct representations of f, that is, f equal to gq1 plus r1 and it is also equal to gq2 plus r2 for some polynomials q1, q2, r1 and r2 over f. Then just by simple rearrangement, we have g times q1 minus q2 equal to r2 minus r1. Observe that if q1 is equal to q2, then r1 is equal to r2 because both sides have to be 0. Similarly, if r1 equal to r2, And since the divisor polynomial g is not identically 0, then by using the last lemma, you can conclude that q1 minus q2 is 0, that is q1 equal to q2. So now let us assume that neither of them holds, that is q1 is not equal to q2 and r1 is not equal to r2. That means q1 minus q2 is not identically 0, in which case it has a well-defined degree. Let us say q1 minus q2 has degree at least 0, 0, 1 or so on. We have fixed a particular representation of q1 minus q2, so the degree is defined for us. By multiplying with g, we observe that if we consider the polynomial g times q1 minus q2, then this polynomial has degree at least degree of g, because let us say the degree of g is n, then you have the x power n coefficient here in g, and let us say the degree of q1 minus q2 is m, then you have the x power m coefficient in q1 minus q2, and they multiply out to give x power n plus m, and n plus m is at least n. But r1 is either identically 0 or has degree at most equal to the degree of g minus 1, and the same is the case for r2. In that case, this r1 minus r2 or r2 minus r1 has degree less than the degree of g either ways, whereas the left hand side, that is g times q1 minus q2, has degree at least equal to the degree of g, and hence you get a contradiction, and this proves the uniqueness of q1 and r1. Next we have an example. Suppose we are considering the field to be C and you want to divide x power 100 minus 2 x power 51 by x square minus 1. By the division algorithm, since the degree of x square minus 1 is 2, there exists a polynomial of degree at most 1 such that x power 100 minus 2 x power 51 is equal to x square minus 1 into q of x plus ax plus b. Note that ax plus b can be identically 0 also. Now, q is some unknown complex polynomial which we will find out. Now we will use substitution. Let us put x equal to 1 and minus 1. In that case, you get a plus b is equal to minus 1 and minus a plus b equal to 3. Solving these two equations simultaneously, you get a equal to minus 2 and b equal to plus 1. So the required remainder ax plus b is minus 2x plus 1. Now the motivation behind substituting this 1 and minus 1 was that x square minus 1 has these two roots, 1 and minus 1 in C. So when we substitute that in this place, then this term becomes 0. And then we only have to deal with ax plus b and x power 100 minus 2x power 51, and that makes our work easy. And this is the general procedure to solve any division algorithm problem. Now we have an exercise. We know that z is not a field. And why is it so? Just consider the inverses. Now, under the usual addition and multiplication, although z is not a field, we can define a polynomial over it. It is very simple, just define it to be a polynomial with coefficients in z, and you are defining it over z, so the value of x can only be z. So it's a function from z to z, which looks like a polynomial and has integer coefficients. Now you can check using some counter examples that the division algorithm in general does not hold. Nevertheless, the division algorithm does hold if this g is monic, that is the leading coefficient is 1. This is an exercise. Now the second exercise is, consider the polynomial ax power 4 plus bx cube plus cx square plus dx plus e, where a, b, c, d and e are in z, and you are considering x takes only the values in z, so basically it is a polynomial over z. Suppose it is given that the coefficients have been selected in such a way that this expression is always divisible by 7 for every integer z, sorry x, and then you can show that 7 divides each of a, b, c, d and e. The hint is, use lemma 2 in a suitable field. Now we consider polynomials over C. We will restrict our attention only to the field of complex numbers. Complex numbers have a very useful property, that is the fundamental theorem of algebra, which says that if you have a non-constant polynomial over complex numbers, will always have a loop. That is, it will always have a value x belongs to C for which f of x equal to 0. Well, although it is all the fundamental theorem of algebra, it is not at all fundamental. Its proof requires a lot of undergraduate concepts, and we will not deal with them in this lecture. Now we have a theorem. Every polynomial of degree equal to n over complex numbers has exactly n roots counted with repetitions. Now, since we are talking about the degree of the polynomial, we have assumed that the polynomial is not identically zero. Now, let alpha be a root of f. We apply the division algorithm and we get f of x equal to x minus alpha g of x plus c by the division algorithm. Now, if we substitute the root alpha in this equation, then you get f of alpha is equal to c, and that is equal to 0. So we get that f of x equal to x minus alpha into g of x. Now it is easy to see that the degree of g is equal to degree of f minus 1. Just multiply it out. X multiplies with the highest power of x in g and it gives f. So the highest power of x in g must be equal to 1 less than the highest power of f. Then if we assume that every polynomial of degree n minus 1 has exactly n minus 1 roots counted with repetitions, then f will have exactly n roots where n is the degree of g. So this gives an idea of using induction, and it is an exercise to complete the proof using induction. We come to a useful factorization of f. You know that if alpha is a root, then f of x equal to x minus alpha into g of x for some complex polynomial g. Now you can do the same for g again. If g is a non-constant polynomial, then you can find a root beta, and you can write g as x minus beta into h of x for some complex polynomial h, and do the same for h, and continue doing it this way till you do get a constant polynomial. In that case, f looks like x minus alpha 1 into x minus alpha 2 and so on up to x minus alpha n into some constant c. Now bring this constant c to the left. So f is equal to c times x minus alpha i's product. Now if you just compare the coefficient of x power n both sides, then on the left hand side you have an and on the right hand side you have c. So c must be equal to n because the set of complex numbers is an infinite field. So the coefficients must match. Now we have this representation f of x equal to an times x minus alpha 1 into x minus alpha 2 to x minus alpha n, where all the alpha i's are the roots of f and an is the leading coefficient of f. Now we have an exercise based on this factorization. Suppose alpha, beta, gamma and delta are the roots of the equation x power 4 plus px cube plus qx square plus rx plus s equal to 0. You have to show that the expression 1 plus alpha square into 1 plus beta square into 1 plus gamma square into 1 plus delta square is equal to 1 minus q plus s whole square plus p minus r whole square. End is as follows. You take 1 plus alpha square and factorize it as iota plus alpha into minus iota plus alpha, where iota is the imaginary square root of minus 1. Now observe that if you use this factorization, then again you can apply the factorization of the polynomial f that we discussed earlier, and it will help you solve the exercise. The fact that a polynomial of degree n has at most n distinct roots is indeed very useful in proving that a certain polynomial satisfying some conditions is identically zero. The proof generally goes as follows. Suppose the polynomial f is non-zero, then it will have some well-defined degree n. N belongs to n star. Now, if you can show that there are at least n plus 1 distinct roots, you will get a contradiction and the proof will be done. Let us take an example. Suppose a, b and c are distinct complex numbers such that this expression x minus a into x minus b divided by c minus a into c minus b plus x minus b into x minus c divided by a minus b into a minus c plus x minus c into x minus a divided by b minus c into b minus a is equal to 1 for all x in a set of complex numbers. Now we have to show this, that this expression holds as an identity. Now we want to use polynomials, so we consider this polynomial, that is this expression minus 1, and we want to show that this is identically 0. So how do we do that? Let us assume that it is indeed non-zero, then it will have some well-defined degree. Now if you just multiply out this, then you see that the degree can be at most 2, because there are 2 x's here, so you will get x square, and that you will get from every expression. So the degree is at most 2. Now can you find 3 distinct roots? Well, it is obvious, because you already have a, b and c distinct complex numbers. Just substitute a and you see that you will get 0, similarly for b and c. So this polynomial whose degree could have been at most 2 has 3 distinct roots. So that is a contradiction. In that case, the polynomial has to be identically equal to 0. And we are done. If the polynomial is identically 0, then this expression holds as an identity. Another exercise, find all polynomials f over c which satisfy this functional equation, f of x square plus f of x into f of x plus 1 is identically 0 for all x in c. The hint is as follows. Suppose alpha is a root of the polynomial f, such that alpha is not 0 and mod alpha is not 1, that is alpha does not lie on the unit circle and alpha is not at the origin, then you can show that this sequence alpha power 2 power n, where n is greater than or equal to 1, is a sequence of infinitely many distinct zeros. So use this, and if you can show this, then f will be identically equal to 0, because a polynomial of degree say k cannot have infinitely many zeros. So it must not have a degree. In that case, f has to be identically 0. That is part 1. And secondly, further, if a point lies on the unit circle and is a root of f, then you can show that it must be 1. And now you have only two kinds of roots, that is 0 and 1. Now you just factorize f in terms of its roots 0 and 1, and just see that what kind of expression must f have in order for this functional equation to hold. Now we come to Vieta's relations in C. Suppose we have a non-constant polynomial f, then f can be written as an times x minus alpha 1 times x minus alpha 2 and so on up to x minus alpha n, where alpha is at the roots of f. Let us try to expand this product on the right hand side. Suppose we want to create the x power k term, then from exactly k of these brackets we need to choose an x to get x power k, and from the remaining n minus k brackets we need to choose the alpha i's. But again, there is a minus sign with each alpha I. So if you choose n minus k alpha i's, then we get minus 1 power n minus k. Further, we have an an hanging around in the beginning. So the coefficient of x power k will be summation an times minus 1 power n minus k alpha i1, alpha i2 up to alpha I n minus k, where these i1, i2, i n minus k are in increasing order, and all are from 1 to n. So from that we get Vieta's relation. The coefficient of x power k on the left hand side will be ak, that is f has the form an x power n, an minus 1, x power n minus 1, so on, then ak x power k, ak minus x power k minus 1 and so on. So the coefficient of x power k is ak, but on the right hand side, by expanding the product, we got the coefficient is of this form. So just by dividing by an, which we can do because an is non-zero, we get this product alpha i1, alpha i2 up to alpha in minus k, and then summed over all the possible values of i1, i2 up to in minus k is simply equal to minus 1 power n minus k into ak by an. This just says that the sum of product of these alphas taken n minus k at a time is equal to this simple expression minus 1 power n minus k into ak by an. These are called the Vieta's relations, and we will see some application. Suppose a, b and c are real numbers. such that the sum of k, b and c are greater than 0. The sum of products taken two at a time is greater than 0. And the product is greater than 0. Then you have to show that they are all positive. That is, a, b and c are all positive. Now, since we have this kind of expression, it is a good idea to use Vieta's relations or something similar to that. So first we need a polynomial. Let us say we take the polynomial x minus a into x minus b into x minus c, which has roots a, b and c. On expanding it, you get this kind of an expression, that is x cube minus a plus b plus c x square plus a b plus b c plus c a x minus a b c. Observe that if you substitute a negative number or 0, then this expression is negative. So if you have a root x naught, then that root must be positive. And the roots are precisely a, b and c, and that means a, b and c are all positive. And the proof is done. Now we have two exercises. Given that the sum of two of the roots of 4x cubed plus ax square minus x plus b equal to 0 is 0, where a and b are rational numbers, solve the equation for all possible values of a and b. Second exercise is, find all such a and b such that the roots of this equation x cubed plus ax square plus bx minus x equal to 0 are real and are in geometric progression. It is there of the form alpha, alpha r, alpha r square, where alpha and r are non-zero. Next we come to an important topic, that is roots of unity. Suppose we consider the complex polynomial x power n minus 1 has degree n and has exactly n roots counted with repetitions. Although indeed there are no repetitions in this case, but in general if you have degree n, roots might be repeated in the factorization. So it has exactly n roots with repetitions. How many times they are repeated is unknown right now. Now the roots of this polynomial are known as the nth roots of unity, where n belongs to a natural number. If we let alpha equal to e power 2 pi iota by n, that is equal to cos 2 pi by n plus iota sin 2 pi by n, then the nth roots of unity are precisely alpha power 1, alpha power 2 and so on up to alpha power n. If you plot it on the Argand plane, they have a beautiful geometric feature. They occupy the vertices of a regular n1, which is centered at the origin and has circumradius 1. We have an example on the applications of nth roots of unity. Suppose you consider the polynomial x power 2k plus 1 plus x plus 1 whole power 2k, where k belongs to natural number, and k is such that this polynomial is not divisible by x square plus x plus 1, then find all possible values of k. So we consider the negative statement, that is, if x square plus x plus 1 indeed divides the real polynomial, then if you substitute omega equal to e power 2 pi I by 3, that is the third root of unity, imaginary third root of unity, then since x square plus x plus 1 has this root, then any real polynomial which it divides must also have this as a root. Just by the division algorithm, you can see that. As an exercise, show that the converse is also true. That is, if omega is a root of a real polynomial f, then the polynomial is indeed divisible by x square plus x plus 1. Apply the division algorithm and prove the converse. Consequently, if a polynomial f, let us say this polynomial, that is x power 2k plus 1 plus x plus 1 whole power 2k, is not divisible by x square plus x plus 1, then omega must not be a root of f. Conversely, if omega is not a root of f, then this polynomial is not divisible by x square plus x plus 1. So the condition that this polynomial is not divisible by x square plus x plus 1 is translated to the condition that omega is not a root of this polynomial. If I substitute omega, you see that it is omega power 2k plus 1 plus omega plus 1 whole square power k. Now omega plus 1 whole square is omega, you can see it by expanding. And so f of omega is equal to omega power 2k plus 1 plus omega power k. Now consider the case when k is equal to 3m, that is, k is a multiple of 3, then omega power 2k is 1 because k is a multiple of 3. omega bar k is also 1, so this expression just evaluates to 3, not equal to 0. So in that case, f will not be divisible by x square plus x plus 1. But observe that for k equal to 3m plus 1, for example, omega bar 2k is simply omega power 3m plus 1 into 2, that is omega power 6m plus 2, that is omega square. Similarly, omega power k is omega power 3m plus 1, that is simply omega. So this f of omega is nothing but omega square plus omega plus 1, it is 0. Similarly, for k equal to 3m plus 2 also, you have f of omega equal to 0. In that case, for k equal to 3m plus 1 and 3m plus 2, omega is a root of f, and f is divisible by x squared plus x plus 1. So the values of k belongs to natural number for which x squared plus x plus 1 does not divide that polynomial f is precisely the set of all multiples of 3. Now we have another exercise. Let k be an integer and n be a natural number. Show that the GCD, the greatest common divisor of k and n, is 1 if and only if the powers of alpha power k generate the entire set of nth roots of unity. That is, if you consider alpha power k, alpha power 2k, and then alpha power minus k, alpha power minus 2k, and so on, and alpha power 0 also, then you will get all the nth roots of unity. A hint is, consider the set kx plus ny, where x and y are integers. Another exercise. You have learned about Vieta's relations. Now consider the Vieta's relations for the polynomial x power n minus 1 and interpret them. For example, for n greater than or equal to 2, the sum of nth roots of unity will be 0. Why? Because the coefficient of x power n minus 1 in that case will be 0. Similarly, the product of nth roots of unity will be minus 1 power n plus 1. Why? Because the product of the roots will be minus 1 power n into minus 1. So it's minus 1 power n plus 1, and that is true for all n greater than equal to 1. Another exercise based on the geometric feature of the roots. Let the vertices of a regular n-gon of circumradius 1 be a1, a2, and so on up to an. Then the product of distances of a1 from the other vertices is to be computed, and it can be computed very easily using complex numbers. Just lay the polynomial on the argon plane with the circumcenter at the origin and the complex number 1 at a1, and just apply Vieta's relations. Types of roots and multiplicity. Properties of the field put severe restrictions on what the roots of a polynomial might be. For example, if you consider a complex polynomial, real coefficients, that is f of x is equal to summation ai x power I, where ai's are all real but x can take complex values, and suppose f has a complex root z, then its complex conjugate, that is z bar, is also a root. The proof is as follows. Suppose f of z is equal to 0, then take conjugate both sides. F of z conjugate is equal to 0 conjugate equal to 0. And since f of z is summation ai x power I, the conjugate goes inside the summation, so you have conjugate of ai z power I. And since ai is a real number, ai conjugate is ai, so conjugate of ai z power I is simply conjugate of z power I. So when you sum it up, you will get f of z conjugate, and that is equal to 0. Further, for a polynomial with real coefficients, imaginary roots, that is complex roots which are not real, occur in conjugate pairs. Formally, it means that suppose alpha plus iota beta is a root, where beta is non-zero, then alpha minus iota beta is also a root. Now observe that since beta is non-zero, this z is not equal to z bar, where z equal to alpha plus iota beta. That is because z is not a real number. Further, these roots must be repeated the same number of times in the factorization of f using its roots. That is, z and z bar must occur the same number of times. Suppose we want to prove this. Assume that z occurs k times and z bar occurs l times in the factorization, but l is not equal to k. without loss of generality, we can assume that L is greater than D. Then how do we factorize F? First, club up K times x minus z times x minus z bar. That is, club up the k copies of them. Then look at the factorization. You have one bracket inside which you have product from I equal to 1 to k x minus z into x minus z bar into another polynomial which is leading coefficient an times x minus z bar power l minus k into the terms with the other roots, that is x minus a into x minus b and so on. Where none of the remaining roots a, b and so on is equal to z or z bar, that is all of z and z bar are concentrated in the first part of the factorization. And an is a real number. Observe that this product from I equal to 1 to k x minus z into x minus z bar is a real polynomial. It is easy to prove this. Just multiply out x minus z and x minus z bar and show that it is a real polynomial. But we know that f is also a real polynomial. So you have h one real polynomial and f another real polynomial. Then by applying the division algorithm over R, this gives us f equal to h into q, where q is another real polynomial. But this factorization is still valid when u over c, because if you just go over the proof of the division algorithm, you will see that nowhere actually you use the fact that x belongs to R or x belongs to c. As long as you are dealing with a real polynomial and you have its factorization over R, factorization will also be valid over C. And not just R and C, it is true for any field F and its subfield F dashed. That is, if you have a polynomial whose coefficients are in F dashed and you have a factorization of that polynomial, then the same factorization holds also in F. Now we already have F of x is equal to h of x into an into x minus z bar power l minus k to x minus a into x minus b and so on, where h of x is the product we got earlier, that is product from I equal to 1 to k x minus z into x minus z bar. But just now using division algorithm we got another factorization, that is f equal to h into q. Then by uniqueness part of the division algorithm over c, because c is a infinite field, we must have q equal to this polynomial an times x minus z bar power l minus k into x minus a into x minus b and so on. But since the left hand side q is a real polynomial, this right hand side must also be a real polynomial. As l is greater than k, l minus k is at least 1. Then z bar is the root of this polynomial. Just substitute z bar, you will get 0. However, the conjugate of z bar, that is z, does not occur anywhere among the roots of this polynomial. It means that this is a real polynomial, but it does not have z bar in conjugate pairs, and that gives us a contradiction. We can do a similar thing for irrational roots of polynomials over Q. For example, if 2 plus square root of 5 is a root of a polynomial f over Q, we have to show that 2 minus square root of 5, or this irrational conjugate, is also a root using the following exercises. Show that if P and Q are rational numbers such that p plus q square root of 5 is 0, then both p and q must be 0. Consequently, p minus q square root of 5 must also be 0. Next, write down f of x as summation I equal to 0 to n ai x power I and substitute 2 plus square root of 5. So you get summation I equal to 0 to n ai 2 plus square root of 5 whole power I. Now show that this expression is equal to p plus q square root of 5 for some rational numbers p and q. To do that, just use the binomial theorem and expand this 2 plus square root of 5 whole power I and club up the terms with even and odd powers of square root of 5. If you have root 5 power 2k, then that is simply 5 power k. And if you have root 5 power 2k plus 1, that is simply 5 power k into root 5. So the root 5 comes out and sum over all such possible odd powers of root 5 and you get an extra root 5 hanging around. So when you just look at the expression, it just looks like p plus q square root of 5, where p and q are rational numbers. Next exercise, show that if f of 2 plus square root of 5 is p plus q square root of 5 as above, then f of 2 minus square root of 5 is p minus q square root of 5, where p and q are rational numbers. And the last part is, conclude from these exercises that 2 minus square root of 5 is also a root. Now another exercise, using a similar idea as we did before for complex polynomials, show that 2 plus square root of 5 and 2 minus square root of 5 must occur the same number of times in the factorization of f in terms of its roots. The number of times a particular root occurs in the factorization in terms of roots of a complex polynomial is called the multiplicity of the root. The division algorithm and calculus give us a particularly useful criterion to determine the multiplicity of a real root of a real polynomial. Now, the same relation will hold for complex roots of complex polynomials, but we won't deal with that because it requires the definition of derivatives for complex functions. First, we need a theorem, Taylor's theorem for polynomials. Let f be a polynomial of degree n over R and a belong to R, then f of x can be written as this sum k equal to 0 to infinity, f k the derivative evaluated at a divided by k factorial into x minus a whole power k. Although it seems that it extends up to infinity, but the sum is indeed finite because since f has degree n, then derivatives of order n plus 1 or higher are all 0. You are encouraged to prove this theorem by induction on the degree of f. It is not at all difficult. You just take the derivative on both sides and take the derivative inside the summation. You will get the answer. Another hint is induction on the degree. So you want to look at the degree of f dash and see what happens. Now suppose we have another expansion, f of x equal to summation k equal to 0 to infinity a k times x minus a whole power k. That is, instead of f k derivative at a by k factorial, we have a k this time, where a k is 0 except for finite number of terms, so that this summation is basically finite. Then just manually differentiate this entire expression a times and see that f k derivative evaluated at a by k factorial, which we get, is equal to a k for all k belongs to n star. Then consequently, this expansion just matches with the Taylor expansion that we saw just now. This expansion, called the Taylor expansion of f around a in terms of the powers of x minus a, is unique because indeed a k is equal to f k derivative at a by k factorial. But you can prove the uniqueness of the Taylor expansion in another way. Prove the uniqueness using the division algorithm. That is, divide by x minus a and see what happens. Suppose we consider the special case when this a is a root of f, then we can write down f of x equal to x minus a whole power k into g of x, where g is another real polynomial and this k is the multiplicity of a in the factorization of f. To complete the following exercises, write down the Taylor expansion of this g in terms of its derivatives about a. The coefficient of x minus a whole power 0 will be non-zero as a is not a root of g. By multiplying out x minus a whole power k, the Taylor expansion above, obtain the Taylor expansion of f. Now by uniqueness of the Taylor expansion, show that f derivative l at a is equal to 0 for 0 lesser than equal to l lesser than equal to k minus 1, and f derivative k at a is non-zero. Conversely, suppose f l derivative at a is 0 for 0 lesser than equal to l lesser than equal to k minus 1, and f k derivative at a is non-zero for some natural number k, then by factoring out x minus a whole power k, show that indeed a has multiplicity k in the factorization of f. Now an exercise, suppose you have a polynomial x minus 1 whole square and another polynomial n into x power n plus 1 minus n plus 1 into x power n plus 1 over r, and show that the polynomial on the left divides the polynomial on the right. And a simple hint is, look at the multiplicity of 1 in the expansion of the polynomial on the right. Another exercise, find a degree 4 equation, that is You want a quartic equation with rational coefficients, one of whose roots is the irrational number root 3 plus root 7. Another exercise is, can this degree be lowered? That is, can you find a polynomial of degree at most 3, one of whose zeros is root 3 plus root 7? A hint for doing the second part is, suppose the degree can be lowered to at most 3. Then by expanding using binomial theorem, find out what other irrational numbers must be roots of the polynomial. Just like we saw in the case of 2 plus root 5, 2 minus root 5 is also a root. Find such other roots for root 3 plus root 7. Another exercise, suppose f and g are non-zero real polynomials such that f of x square plus x plus 1 is equal to f of x times g of x, then you have to show that f has an even degree. By real polynomial here I mean the coefficients are real, but the values of x can be complex numbers, of course. A hint, if f has a real zero, that if there exists an alpha in C such that f of alpha is 0, then show that if you apply this function x square plus x plus 1 to alpha, then the result will also be a 0 of f. You keep doing this again and again, keep on applying the function x square plus x plus 1 and generate a sequence of distinct real zeros. Second hint, if you have a non-real zero, that is imaginary zeros, then they occur in conjugate pairs because f has coefficients in R. Let f be an arbitrary field in which we have n distinct scalars c1, c2 and so on up to cn. So now we want a polynomial f which will give us 0 at each of these data points. So it's easy to find. Just take f of x equal to x minus c1 times x minus c2 and so on up to x minus cn. This evaluates to 0 at each of those n scalars. Now we want to extend this idea. Instead of 0, we want some other values at these ci's. Suppose now we want a polynomial which gives 1 for c1 and 0 for the other scalars. Since we want all the other scalars to be roots of this polynomial x minus c2, x minus c3 and so on up to x minus cn is a good candidate for it. But there's a problem. At c1, it takes the value c1 minus c2, c1 minus c3 and so on up to c1 minus cn instead of 1. So to get 1, we will divide the candidate x minus c2 times x minus c3 up to x minus cn by c1 minus c2 into c1 minus c3 up to c1 minus cn. So we get f of x equal to product I equal to 2 to n x minus ci by cj minus ci. This satisfies our conditions because at c1 it takes 1 and at all the other scalars it takes 0. Similarly, instead of c1, suppose at cj we want 1 and at all the other scalars we want 0. So we can choose the polynomial fj equal to product I not equal to j x minus ci by cj minus ci. This gives 1 at cj and 0 at the other scalars. Now suppose we want to do better. Instead of 1s and 0s, we want the polynomial to take some arbitrary scalar values. Suppose we want a polynomial which gives the value aj at cj. Now can we get such a polynomial from some combination of fj's which we found earlier? Since we don't know what combination to take, let us take gx equal to summation j equal to 1 to n lambda j fjx, where lambda j's are unknown, we want to find them. Now since we want g to satisfy this condition, it takes aj at cj, we want gcj to be aj. But observe that gcj is nothing but lambda j, because at cj this fjx takes 1 and all the others take 0. So if gcj is aj, then lambda j has to be equal to aj. So g has to be the polynomial summation j equal to 1 to n aj fjx. Indeed, if you evaluate it at all the scalars, you will observe that at each cj it takes the value aj for all 1 lesser than equal to j lesser than equal to n. This polynomial g is called the Lagrange polynomial with respect to these given data points data points here are c1, a1, c2, a2, and so on up to cn, an. Now here is an exercise. Show that over a given field f, if there is a polynomial f of degree at most n minus 1, which takes n specified values at n distinct scalars, then it must be the Lagrange polynomial with respect to the given data points. In other words, the interpolation polynomial of degree at most n minus 1 with respect to those data points is unique. That is, if you want the polynomial which at given scalars c1, c2 and so on up to cn takes the values a1, a2 up to an, then if you further impose the restriction that f must have a degree at most n minus 1, then this f is indeed unique and it is the Lagrange polynomial which we found out earlier. A hint might be, let L be the Lagrange polynomial with respect to the data points and P be another interpolation polynomial which takes the given values at the given scalars. Then can you say something about the roots of L minus P? Now here is an example. Let F be a real polynomial of degree 2 such that f of 0 is 0, f of 1 is half, and f of 2 is 2 by 3. Find out f of 3. Now since f has a degree 2, it has degree at most 2, because if degree is equal to 2, degree is lesser than equal to 2. But we have 3 given data points, 0, 1 and 2, and the values 0, half and 2 by 3. So by the previous exercise, f must be the Lagrange polynomial. And the Lagrange polynomial in this case, if you just write down, is x times x minus 2 divided by 2 into minus 1 plus x times x minus 1 into 2 by 3 divided by 2. Now the leading coefficient of this polynomial is nothing but minus half plus 1 by 3, which is not 0. So you can at least assure that the question is correct, that indeed this polynomial f must have degree 2 and not some smaller degree like 1, or it must not be a constant polynomial. So now it's easy to evaluate f of 3. Just put 3 here, you will get 3 into 1 by 2 into minus 1 and 2/3 into 3 into 2 by 2, and that is nothing but half. Another exercise is to generalize the previous result. In the previous question, we saw only 3 data points, that is at 0 it takes 0 by 0 plus 1, at 1 it takes 1 by 1 plus 1, at 2 it takes 2 by 2 plus 1, and we want the value at 3. So instead, we will consider n data points and generalize the previous result. Another exercise is to solve this generalized problem using division algorithm or by factorizing a particular polynomial in terms of its roots in order to obtain fn plus 1. Let f be a polynomial with integer coefficients and p be a prime number such that f of 0 is congruent to 0 modulo p, f of 1 is congruent to 1 modulo p, and f of k is congruent to either 0 or 1 modulo p for every natural number k greater than or equal to 2. By this I mean f of 2 might be 0, f of 3 might be 1, f of 4 might be again 1, or let's say f of 2 might be 1, f of 3 might be 0, and so on. Any combination. Only restriction is f of 0 has to be 0 and f of 1 has to be 1 in fp. Then show that the degree of this polynomial f must be at least p minus 1. Some hints. First hint is, it suffices to consider the values of f for 0, 1 and so on up to p minus 1 as we are viewing modulo p. So instead of viewing for arbitrary x, f of x can be viewed only for 0 to p minus 1. Because if x is congruent to some r, where r is in fp, then f of x is congruent to f of r modulo p. Second hint, suppose f has degree less than p minus 1, that is we are trying to bring about a contradiction, then fp must be the Lagrange polynomial with respect to the given data points. Now we want to contradict the previous assumption. Now we assume that the polynomial has degree less than p minus 1, but the Lagrange polynomial in general has the freedom to be degree exactly equal to p minus 1. So we are going to show that. First, we will assume that this polynomial has degree less than p minus 1, so it must be the Lagrange polynomial, and we will compute the Lagrange polynomial and show that indeed the polynomial has degree equal to p minus 1. For that, calculate the coefficient of x bar p minus 1 in the Lagrange polynomial and show that it is non-zero in FP. Now, hint 4. In the above hint, for showing that the coefficient of x bar p minus 1 is non-zero, we will basically arrive at a number theory problem. That is, you have to show that something is not congruent to 0 modulo p. And for that, the expression that you will get, you can multiply it by p minus 1 factorial and then use the definition of factorial to find out what it evaluates to modulo p. Now we come to a new topic, that is integer polynomials. We will focus our attention to polynomials with integer coefficients. But before that, we will start with a remark. Sometimes in our arguments before, we have been a little sloppy. We have often dealt with real polynomials, but often used the properties of some complex roots of the real polynomial. Whereas whenever we define polynomials over real numbers, we have the restriction of x being in reals only. However, you see that such a restriction is not necessary. What matters most is that the coefficients must be in reals or rationals or complex numbers and so on. So whenever we have, say, a polynomial over rationals, we can always consider it to be over reals too, because every rational number is a real number. Same, we can view every real polynomial over the field of complex numbers too. When we talk of polynomials over a field f, we can always view it over a larger field, say f dashed, of which f is a subfield, that is a subset with the same laws of addition and multiplication. Now suppose we don't have a field. Suppose we consider the set of integers z. It is not a field, but as we discussed earlier, we can always define a polynomial over z. Now we can still view polynomials over z as polynomials over the set of complex numbers, because every integer is a complex number. And further, because the laws of addition and multiplication of complex numbers, when restricted to the set of integers, just mimics the laws of addition and multiplication of integers, except for the fact that the existence of multiplicative inverse is not true in Z, though it will exist in C for non-zero integers. But you have to be careful. Suppose you have a prime p and a polynomial over fp. Since every remainder modulo p is also an integer, you might be tempted to consider this polynomial over integers instead of over fp. Well, it is correct, but there is a problem. Since the laws of addition and multiplication are different for fp and z, so translating the conditions in fp to z will be a bit difficult. We must reduce all coefficients as well as values of x modulo that prime and translate all the conditions in z to conditions in fp. To be more rigorous, an important property which we have used for the sets we have dealt with so far is that they were infinite. Suppose a complex polynomial has infinitely many roots, then it must be identically zero. Consequently, suppose f and g be two polynomials with integer coefficients, such that f of x is same as g of x at all integers x, then the polynomial f of x minus g of x, when viewed over the set of complex numbers, has infinitely many distinct roots. At least all the integers are its roots. So it must be identically 0 over c. Hence, f of x is equal to g of x for all complex numbers x. Now the converse is trivially true. If f of x is equal to g of x for all complex numbers, then f of x is equal to g of x for all integers. So similarly, if we have suppose polynomials f and g with rational coefficients and g not identically zero, then division algorithm over rationals furnishes us unique q and r, so that f of x equal to g of x into q of x plus r of x for every rational number x. But we can view it over real numbers, because every rational number is also a real number, so we can consider f with real coefficients. When viewed over reals, these polynomials agree at least on all rationals, that is f of x equal to g of x into q of x plus r of x for all rational sets. Hence, they agree on infinitely many distinct reals. Consequently, they must agree on all reals because reals are infinitely. Again, the converse is trivial because if this equation holds for all real x, then it must hold for all rational x. Now, when you are working with an arbitrary abstract field, you are encouraged to repeat this kind of an argument when you feel uncomfortable with working in different fields. Basically, there are two things at work here. One of them is the fact that the sets are infinite. So we can always find things like infinitely many distinct roots and so on. And secondly, we are assuming that the laws of addition and multiplication remain unchanged when we are viewing it over a larger field. So these two are important. Now we come to the divisibility property of integer polynomials. Let P be a polynomial with integer coefficients and A and B be two integers. Then we claim that A minus B must divide PA minus PB. Note that PA and PB are integers, so it makes sense to divide them by an integer. Proof. First, we deal with a simple case, that is, we assume P of x equal to x power n, where n is a natural number. Let us define the polynomial f of x to be equal to x power n minus b power n. Then, since f is a polynomial with integer coefficients, we might want to consider division algorithm over z. Consider the monic polynomial x minus b. With monic polynomials as divisors, division algorithm holds over z. So we can find polynomials q and r with integer coefficients such that x power n minus b power n is equal to x minus b times q of x plus r of x, where r is either identically 0 or a constant polynomial because its degree must be less than the degree of its linear polynomial. By substituting x equal to b in this equation, we get 0 on the left, 0 in this term, so r of b must be 0. So even if it's a constant polynomial, it has to be 0. So x power n minus b power n is equal to x minus b times q of x for all integers x. If you put x equal to a, you will obtain a power n minus b power n equal to a minus b times q of a. Now q of a is an integer because all its coefficients are integers and a is also an integer. Hence, you get a minus b divides a power n minus b power n. Now you can deal with the more general case when p of x is equal to summation I equal to 0 to n ci x power I, where each ci belongs to z for all 0 lesser than equal to I lesser than equal to n. Then compute pa minus pb, that is simply summation I equal to 0 to n ci times a power I minus b power I. Now by the previous argument, a minus b must divide a power I minus b power I for I belongs to natural numbers. And anyways, for I equal to 0, this term is 0, so it does not affect the sum. So a minus b divides ci times a power I minus b power I for all I equal to 1 to n, so it must divide this sum. And hence a minus b divides pa minus pb. Now we consider a classical application of the previous lemma. So that there cannot exist three distinct integers a, b and c such that there is a polynomial p with integer coefficients for which p of a is b, p of b is c and p of c is a. So there is basically a cyclic nature in them. Now we are dealing with the values of p at many integers. Say we have p of a, p of b and p of c. So whenever you want to relate the values of p at two distinct integers, applying the previous lemma is a really good bet. So we might want to consider pa minus pb. You already know by the previous lemma that a minus b must divide pa minus pb. So a minus b must divide b minus c. Now doing the same with the pair a comma b replaced by b comma c or c comma a, can conclude that b minus c divides c minus a and c minus a divides a minus b respectively. But from a minus b divides b minus c and b minus c divides c minus a, you get a minus b divides c minus a. But we already have c minus a divides a minus b. Then you can show as an exercise in number theory that a minus b must be either plus or minus c minus a. But since c and b are distinct, we cannot have a minus b equal to minus of c minus a. So we must have a minus b equal to plus c minus a. Similarly, starting from some other pair, we can show that b minus c equal to a minus b. And so we get a string of equalities, a minus b equal to b minus c equal to c minus a. So if x equal to y equal to z, then all of them are equal to x plus y plus z by 3. So x plus y plus z here is 0. So x plus y plus z by 3 is 0. So a minus b, b minus c and c minus a are all 0. So a, b and c are all same, and that gives us a contradiction. And this shows that our assumption was wrong and there is no such polynomial. Next we come to the topic of irreducibility. Suppose we have a polynomial f with integer coefficients. It is said to be reducible over z if there exist two polynomials g and h with integer coefficients and degree at least 1 such that f of x equal to g of x times h of x. In general, you would expect another clause that for all x belongs to integers or rational numbers and so on, but it does not matter because if a polynomial equation holds for all integers, then it must hold for all rational numbers because it holds for infinitely many rational numbers. Similarly, it must hold for all reals and all for all complex numbers, and obviously the converse is true. So we will just say f of x equal to g of x times h of x. A polynomial f with integer coefficients is said to be irreducible over z if it is not reducible over z. Now in general, it is not easy to verify directly f of x equal to g of x into h of x for some polynomials g and h, and hence we need some convenient irreducibility criteria. One of them is Eisenstein's irreducibility criterion. Let n be a natural number and f be a polynomial of degree n with integer coefficients such that there is a prime p for which the following are satisfied. P divides a0, a1 and so on up to an minus 1. P does not divide an, and p square does not divide a0. Then the criterion says that f must be irreducible over z. The idea of proof is to compare coefficients on both sides of the equation f of x equal to g of x times h of x and arrive at a contradiction. Let us assume that there are two polynomials g and h with integer coefficients for which f of x equal to g of x times h of x. Now since g is at least linear, h has degree at most n minus 1. And similarly, since h is at least linear, g has degree at most n minus 1. Now write f of x as summation I equal to 0 to n ai x power I, g of x as summation I equal to 0 to k bi x power I, and h of x as summation I equal to 0 to l ci x power I, where k and l are the degree of g and h respectively. So we have k less than n and l less than n. However, although the summation actually extends up to less than n, we can still extend it to n by taking bi equal to 0 for I greater than k and ci equal to 0 for I greater than l. So we are basically adding some dummy terms to the expression. Now comparing the constant terms on both sides, we get a0 equal to b0 c0. P divides a0, so P must divide b0 or P must divide c0. But it cannot divide both because otherwise we would have p squared dividing a0. So without loss of generality, we can assume that p divides b0 but does not divide c0. Now we will prove that for 0 lesser than or equal to k less than l, p must divide bk. The proof is somewhat inductive, though not exactly induction, because induction generally extends to all natural numbers or to all non-negative integers. But we'll apply the same idea, and in fact you can convert this statement to a statement for all non-negative integers. Basically the statement would be, if 0 lesser than or equal to k less than n, then p divides bk, and if k is greater than or equal to n, then we cannot say anything. And you apply induction to this statement. However, we'll just use the idea. So the base case is already done here, p divides b0. Now suppose k greater than or equal to 0, such that we have p divides bi for I lesser than or equal to k. If k plus 1 is less than n, then he divides ak plus 1, because that is what we assume. But we can write down ak plus 1 by comparing coefficients on both sides. That is, ak plus 1 is summation I equal to 0 to k plus 1 bi c k plus 1 minus I. Now p divides bi for I lesser than equal to k by the induction hypothesis. So p divides bi times c k plus 1 minus I. But we also know that p divides ak plus 1. So p must divide the last term in this summation, that is p divides bk plus 1 times c naught. But we assume that p does not divide c naught. In that case, p must divide bk plus 1. Now the induction hypothesis holds, and by induction the claim follows. Now look at the coefficient of x power n on both sides. An must be summation I equal to 0 to n bi cn minus I. But we know that for 0 lesser than equal to I lesser than equal to n minus 1, p divides bi cn minus I, because p divides bi. But p does not divide an. So p must not divide the last term in this summation. So p must not divide bn times c naught. So p must not divide bn and p must not divide c naught. But since the degree of g is k, which is less than n, by our definition earlier, bn is 0 because n is greater than k. But that's a contradiction because p divides 0. Hence the result is proved. Now we want to extend the Eisenstein's criterion, and we can say that let f be a polynomial with integer coefficients with degree n in natural numbers. Suppose there is an integer k which is 0 lesser than equal to k lesser than equal to n minus 1, and a prime p such that p divides ai for 0 lesser than equal to I lesser than equal to k. P does not divide ak plus 1, and p squared does not divide a naught. So initially we had k equal to n minus 1 in Eisenstein criterion. We are generalizing it to arbitrary k lesser than equal to n minus 1. Then you can show that f has an irreducible factor of degree at least k plus 1. The sketch of proof is very similar to the proof of Eisenstein's irreducibility criterion. Suppose for the sake of contradiction that every irreducible factor of f has degree at most k, then you keep on factoring f. Factor f into g times h, and then factor g into some g1 times g2, h into h1 times h2, and keep on factoring till you get an irreducible factor of degree at most k. Let us call it g dashed. So write f as g dashed x times h dashed x. By comparing coefficients as before, show that p does not divide ak plus 1, where ai is the coefficient of x power I in g dashed. This will be a contradiction because ak plus 1 is 0 because k plus 1 is greater than k. Complete the proof yourself. An exercise: let n greater than 1 be an integer. Then show that this polynomial x power n plus 5 into x power n minus 1 plus 3 is irreducible over z. And the idea is to use extended Eisenstein's criterion.